Hello everyone, myself Raju Bilgi, Assistant Professor in the Department of Computer Science and Engineering, Acharya Institute of Technology, Bengaluru. I am handling this discrete mathematical structures with a subject code 18CS36. So today we are going to discuss what is meant by discrete mathematical structure or discrete mathematics, then later why we have to study this discrete mathematic structure. Discrete mathematics is the study of discrete objects. When I say discrete, it means distinct or not connected. So this particular discrete mathematics is a fundamental mathematics component which is used for computer science and allied disciplines. So for all this, the set theory is a foundation for discrete mathematics. Even your algebraic structures are also based on this sets. So with this, let us understand why we have to study discrete mathematics. So if you look at the first point, it develops your mathematical thinking. So anyone, the ability to think mathematically, so that will be developed using this discrete mathematics. Second point, it improves the problem solving ability, or it improves the problem solving capacity. And in the field of computer science and engineering, this particular discrete mathematics, or the applications of this particular discrete mathematics, can be used in the subjects like compiler design, machine learning, computer networks, computer security, automata theory, and graph theory, and so on and so forth. So apart from all these particular subjects, even many other problems can be solved using this particular discrete mathematics. Okay, now as I told earlier, for all this, we are going to use a discrete mathematics. For example, where exactly we are using this? Sorting the list of particular integers, we will see like how exactly we are going to use the concept of this particular discrete mathematics in the last module. Then say for example, if you want to find out a shortest path from one place to another place. Say for example, shortest path from your home to your friend's home, you are going to use the applications of this discrete mathematics. Then suppose if I want to find out total how many number of possible combinations of different passwords can be generated using just 8 alphanumeric characters. There are many ways to, it is something called permutation and combination, again which is a concept which is used in a discrete mathematics. Then another one is encrypt the message and deliver it to a friend, and you don't want anybody to read that particular message except your friend. So where you are going to use the concept of encryption and decryption, which is again a application of a discrete mathematics. Okay, so now with all the basic introduction about this particular discrete mathematics, now we are going to start with the first concepts, which is a set theory. Okay, it is a very quite basic one, a definition of a set. So a collection of well-defined objects without a repetition is called as a set. Okay, and these objects which are present in a particular set are called as elements or members. Okay, so this one other important thing is without a repetition. So the objects which are present in the set should not be repeated. I have written some different examples. The set of formal Nobel Prize winners. Okay, the second is the set of the number of students in computer science and engineering. And third point is the integers between 0 to 9. And fourth one, prime numbers which are less than 1000. So like this, you can write any number of examples. But there are two important points to remember. One is each element of the set is written only once. So that is what without repetition. The second point, order of the elements in a given set is not important. Now, how you are going to represent this set? Usually these sets can be represented or denoted by capital case letters or uppercase letters, which are like A comma B comma C. I have represented here. And the elements of this particular sets, or even you can call it as a members of this particular sets, will be represented by small case letters A comma B comma C, or even with some special symbols also. Okay, now just for one example, I have taken one set. Set A is equal to A comma B comma C comma D, and all these members are written within a pair of flower brackets. Okay, now here if you look at B, which is belonging to A, that is B belongs to A, which indicates B is an element of a set A, or B is in A, or B is member of A. All three are same. Okay, and another one, I will take F does not belong to A, which indicates F is not an element of a particular set A, or even I can write it as F is not in A, or even I can write F is not a member of A. So this is how we are going to represent the members which belongs to a particular set, or which does not belong to particular set A. So here I have written symbol indicates belongs to, and this belongs does not belong to. So this is one example I have taken. We'll see now. Now there are two different methods in order to represent these particular sets. So any one of these two we can use. In further part of the particular chapter, we are going to use both the methods. Okay, coming to the first part, tabulation method. So in tabulation method, all the elements of a set without repetition are written within flower brackets. Okay, so that each and every element will be represented, and they have written within a pair of brackets. However, if the elements are more, few are written and subsequent elements can be guessed. We will see like how we are going to write all this in the further part of the chapter. And here in the second method, we specify the set by stating its characteristic property which all the elements of the set possess. So we are going to represent by one particular rule. We will see like how these two methods can be used to represent a particular set. Okay, now I have taken some of the examples how we are going to write using these two methods. Okay, set A which contains all vowels. Okay, when I say A is equal to A comma E comma I comma O comma U, so I have written all these vowels, okay, within a pair of brackets. So this is what each and every element will be represented like this. But at the same time, I can write a common rule where small x such that x is an vowel. When I write like this, I am going to write all the vowels which are present. Okay, so here A is equal to, I can write x bar such that x is an vowel. Second example, if you look at, if I write A, B is equal to 1 comma 3 comma 5 comma 7 comma 9 up to like 19, it is a prime number, it is an odd integer. Okay, it is a odd positive odd integer which are less than 20. okay, x such that x is a positive odd integer which is less than 20. I can write it using rule method. Now c is equal to minus 3, minus 2, minus 1, 0, 1, 2, 3. So this I am going to write it as, you know, c equal to x such that x is an integer. Now another example, set d is equal to 1, 4, 9, 6. So on and so forth. It is infinite. And here I can write it as using rule method, d is equal to x square such that x belongs to n, where n being the set of a natural number. Okay, you take 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, all these are all set of all these are all natural numbers. Now in general I can write the rule method like this, b equal to x, where x is a season of a year. How I am going to read, b is a set, okay, which contains x such that x is a season of the year. So this is how I am going to write down the sets using tabulation method and rule method. Now when I say in another one, example 2, say for example f is a set, which is represented using a rule method as f such that x is a letter of mathematics. So I am not considering this comma, single comma, so which is a rule method. So at the same time I can write using a tabulation method like each letter of this word mathematics. So m-a-t-h-e-i-c-s. So if you look at this particular method, I'm not going to use the letters m-a-t which are repeated. So only once I'm going to use these letters m comma a comma t. So it should be noted that the repetition of the letters m-a-t has to be avoided when you are using tabulation method here. Okay, so these are the two different examples which we are used to represent a particular set. Now we are going to see what are the different sets, different types of sets. So first one, we are going to talk about finite set, infinite set, singleton sets. So a set is said to be finite if it has a finite number of elements. So countable number of elements, then it is called as a finite set. Otherwise, it is said to be infinite set. And any set which contains only one element is called as a singleton set. I have written three different examples here to represent these three different types of sets. So first one, the set of all positive integers less than 10. If I write like this, a is a set is equal to 0 to 9. Here if you look at, the numbers are countable, so integers are countable, hence it is called as a finite set. At the same time, there is no restriction, the set of all real numbers. So it can be negative, it can be positive, and it can be up to infinite numbers. So hence it is called as infinite set. The third one is the set of all numbers between 10 to 20 which are divisible by 7. So when you look at this, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, 18, 20, between these 10 to 20 numbers, there is only one number which is divisible by 7, so that is 14. So I can write b is equal to, within a pair of a brackets, 14, which contains only one element, that is one number, that is 14. So hence it is called as singleton set. So these are all three different types of sets: finite, infinite, and singleton sets. Now there is another one, a null set. Any set containing no elements is called as a null set or even it is also called as an empty set and is denoted by phi or empty open brackets and close brackets, a pair of brackets with no elements. I have given two different examples here. B, I am using a rule method here. B is equal to x such that x is an even integer which is less than 10 and which is divisible by 5 and except 0 which is divisible by 5. It should be less than 10, it should be even integer and which is should not be equal to 0. When you write here x is equal to, you will find 2, 4, 6, 8. Okay, it is less than 10, so you don't have any elements which are divisible by 5. So this is a justification I am giving here with the black color. Now a is equal to, another example, a is equal to x such that x square plus equal to 0, where x belongs to R and R is the real number and which is the set of all real numbers. So here when you find the roots of this particular x square plus 3 is equal to 0, you will get x square is equal to minus 3, then x square is equal to square root of 3i. So you will get some imaginary number, so which is not a real one. So again it is also a phi. So third one, set A is equal to x such that x is a month containing 32 days. So you don't have any month which contains 32 days. So when you write A, that also you will get it as, you know, a null set. Okay, another type is superset and a subset. Okay, so both the definitions can be covered in a single rule. So if you look at if A and B are two different sets, okay, and every element of A is also an element of B, that is every element A is present in set B. Okay, then we can say that A is a subset of B, or even I can call it as A is contained in B, or B contains A. All three are same subset. And here B is called as a superset of A. Superset of A. I have taken one example where A is equal to 1, 2, 3 and B is equal to 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6 and X is equal to 3, 4, 5 or three different sets. When you look at all the elements of A, 1, 2, 3 are present in B. So that is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3. Okay. So hence A is a subset of B and which will be represented as A subset of B. Now if you look at X, 3, 4, 5 which are not present in A. So I can write it as like A is not a subset of X is not a subset of A. Or even I can write it in another way, like A is not a subset of X. So this is how X not a subset of A. How I am going to, this is how I am going to write as subset. Now there are two important points or note you have to consider. That is, every set is a subset of itself. A subset itself. And every empty set is a subset of any set. Any set you consider, A empty set is a subset of itself. Next is universal set. A universal set is a set which contains all the elements or objects of all other sets, including its own elements. So it is usually denoted by symbol U. Okay, you know already. So we'll write one universal set example. Consider there are three different sets A, B, C, and all the elements of sets A, A, B, C are defined as follows using tabulation method. So A is equal to 1, 3, 6, 8. B is equal to 2, 3, 4, 5. And C is equal to 5, 8, 9. So universal set U, which contains all the elements which belongs to A, B, C. So I can write it as 1 comma 2 comma 3, even though 3 is repeating in all these a and b, I am going to write it once, because in the tabulation method no element is repeated. So 1 2 3 4 5 6 8 9, so this is how we are going to write universal set. So next is cardinality of a set A and power set. Okay, now if you look at the cardinality of a particular set, when we are defining this, we have to have a finite set. If A is a finite set, then number of elements of a set A is referred to as a cardinality of a set A, and it is denoted by n of A. So n of A or your modulus of A. So this mod of A defines the cardinality of a set, and at the same time, if I write n of A, it is a cardinal number of a particular set A, n of A. So considering example, A is equal to 1 2 3 4 5 6 7, if you look at, there are 7 number of elements. So cardinality of this particular set A is represented as mod of A is equal to, at the same time, the cardinal number n of A is equal to 7. So that is why I have highlighted this 7. So next is the power set. When you define a power set, so this is for a particular given set A, this power set contains, or it is a set which contains all the subsets, which contains all the subsets of a set A, okay, it is called as a power set, and it is represented by phi of A. Now example, if A is equal to 1 comma 2 comma 3, there are 3 different elements, then P of A is equal to, first I will write the subsets. So 1 2 is 1 2 3 1 comma 2 1 comma 3 2 comma 3, and even the set itself is also a subset of a set, so it is 1 2 3. So even 5, last one is, say null set is also a subset of any set, so I can write it as a P of A is equal to this. Now when you count these numbers, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, there are 8 numbers, that is P of A is equal to 8. So P of A is equal to, you have 8, so that is cardinality of P of A is equal to 8. Okay, so if A is equal to n, then the cardinality of P of A is equal to 2 to the power of n, which is a general formula. So this you have to remember. So next is different operations which we are going to perform on a set. So there are many operations which we are going to use in further part of this particular module, especially in mathematical logic. First one, union of two sets. So union of any two sets A and B is the set which contains all the elements which belong to A or B, or even to both. Okay, and it is denoted by A union B. Okay, A union B, and I can write by using rule method stating that A union B is equal to X such that X belongs to A or X belongs to B. So this is what a union of two different sets. Now at the same time, I can define intersection of two sets, and also what is meant by disjoint set. If you look at two different sets A and B, consider two different sets A and B, the intersection of two sets A and B is the set containing all the elements which belongs to both A and B. That is, which is a common to A and B is nothing but the intersection of two sets, and it is denoted by A intersection B, and I can write it as A intersection B is equal to flower brackets X such that x belongs to A and x belongs to B. So union operator, union set means or, intersection means and. And if you don't find any common element in both the sets, that is, if A intersection B is equal to null set, then these two sets are called as disjoint sets. Okay, two different sets A and B are said to be disjoint sets if A intersection B is a null set. So this is about your intersection of two different sets and disjoint set. Next, another third one is difference of two sets, which is represented by A minus B. So the difference of two sets A and B is the set that consists of all the elements of which belongs to A but does not belongs to B. So that is, which are present in A but not in B, that is A minus B. I can define it as like A minus B is equal to X such that X belongs to A or X belongs to B. Okay, so this is what your difference of two sets. Similarly, I can write B minus A, C minus A, however we want. Then the next is the complement of a particular set. So whenever you have to define a complement set or complement of a particular set, then you have to have some universals set for your reference, then only I can write it. Okay, if U is a universal set containing a set A, okay, so A is also a part of universal set A, then the complement of a set A is defined as U minus A. So that is the numbers which are present in U but not in A. So that is what the complement of a particular set A, and is denoted by A bar. Okay, A bar. So I can write it as A bar is equal to X such that X belongs to A and X does not belongs to A. That is, all the elements which are present in U but not in A. So that is what the complement of a particular set A. Okay, I have written one example which is going to explain all the definitions. Consider this example. Let U is equal to X such that X belongs to some natural number and X is also less than 15. Well, this is my universal set. And set A is equal to like 1, 2, 3, 4, 6. So these are all the elements of A. And B is equal to 3, 4, 8, 9, 10 is another set, which is B. And C is equal to 1, 7, 13. I have defined. Then find A union B, A intersection B, A minus B, A complement. Now, your U is any number which is less than 15. And which should be a natural number according to this. I can write it as 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 up to 14. So this is U. Now A union B is equal to, what is that? Which belongs to A or B. So I can write it as 1, 2, 3, 4, 6. Okay. Then 3, 4 is already present here. I am not going to write it once again. Then 8, 9, 10. So your A union B is equal to 1, 2, 3, 4, 6, 8, 9, 10. Then A intersection B, it defines as like the numbers which are present both A and B. If you look at 3 and 4 is present in A, 3 and 4 are present in B. So A intersection B is equal to 3 and 4. So that is what A intersection B is all about. Next, A minus B, which indicates the elements which are present in A but not in B. So if you look at 1, 2, then 6, all these numbers which are present in A but absent, but not present in B. So here you have only 3 and 4 which are common. So I can write it as a minus b is 1 to 6. 1 to 6 is a minus b, or difference of a minus b. Then last one is a complement of a. So that is the numbers which are present in u but not in a. So if you look at 1, 2, 3, 4, 6. So you taking out all these 1, 2, 3, 4, 6 from the set u, the remaining numbers, I can write it as complement of a. So that is 5, 7, 8, 9, 10, 12, 13, 14. So these are all what we will call it as the complement of particular set A. Okay. Now, these are the different examples of different set operations. Now, the last part of this particular set, which talks about what are the different laws. So these laws are very, very important, since the same rules we are going to use in the first half, that is in this mathematical logic. Okay, so we will see what are these particular laws. And for your practice, you can take any set A is equal to 1, 2, 3, 4, and you can prove all these using the set. Okay, first is double complement, that is complement of a complement. You take any set A complement of complement is equal to again same set. So this is first law. You can take U is equal to something, you can take A is equal to something, you find out the complement, then again you will get one set, again you find out a complement of it, again you are going to get A. Okay, the second one is idempotent laws, which is A union A is equal to A intersection A is equal to A. You take A is equal to 1, 2, 3, again A is equal to 1, 2, 3. If you find union of that is same as 1, 2, 3, because the same 1, 2, 3 elements are same. So A is equal to 1, 2. Again here A is equal to 1, 2. If you find the intersection, you will get also 1, 2. So this is your second law. So you can prove all these laws, whatever I have written, using the sets. Identity law. So another important identity law is A union null set is A. A union null set is again a set A. A intersection U is again A. Okay, you have to remember all these laws. Inverse laws. A union a complement of A is equal to A. Correct, no? Then A intersection complement of A is 5. Because, so here what it is? You take 1 and 2, you take 3 and 4. So combination of these two will be U. But when you write here, the intersection, there will not be any element common. So domination law. So A union intersection U, sorry, A in union U is equal to U. You take any set and you find out, you know, the R operator or operation with a universal set, again you are going to get a universal set only. Okay, so next is A intersection phi is again Fi, no element is common. Okay, next law is commutative law. So this previous law is called as a domination law. So domination with respect to U and the Fi. So commutative law, A union B is equal to B union A, and A intersection B is equal to A intersection B is equal to B intersection A. Okay, so this is what the commutative law. So next is De Morgan's theorem. A union B, complement of A union B is equal to A complement intersection B complement. So this is when you have a union here, then you are going to have a complement. And when you are a complement here, and you are going to use another one. Intersection, you are going to have a union. So A union A intersection B complement. Complement of A intersection B is equal to A complement union B complement. Okay. So this is what we'll call it as De Morgan's theorem. Then absorption laws. A union A intersection B is equal to A, or A intersection A union B is equal to A. So this is called as absorption law, that you have to remember. Then the associative law. So A union B union C is equal to A union B union C, or even the same with intersection. A intersection B intersection C is equal to A intersection intersection C. And finally, we are going to write these distribution laws. A union B intersection C is equal to A union B intersection intersection A union C. And here A intersection B union A intersection C. So these are all, you know, the different laws with respect to set theory. All these, you know, laws can be proved using taking certain examples. A comma A is equal to 1, 2, 3, B is equal to 2, 3, 4, or C is equal to 1, 3, 4. I will give as an assignment, like how to prove all these laws using different sets. So by knowing all this, now we are going to discuss about the various mathematical logic, which is a very interesting chapter.